Thank you very much for the introduction. Very good afternoon, and my distinguished colleagues and friends, Professor Yoshiori Urano and wife, and also respected Professor Tominaga, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. It is indeed a great honor for me, for the second time, to be part of this university, Waseda University, and also GITS. I came yesterday with a strong desire to meet my old friend and also colleague in our many of our projects, Professor Urano. I've known him for more than almost 14 years, since 1998. And 2 years ago, or almost 2.5 years ago, I came here to give a lecture for Tominaga Sensei. So this is the second time I have this very unique privilege to be associated with very great people of Waseda University. So for this afternoon, I would like to share with you some of my personal observation, my personal experience with regards to transnational collaboration through GITI Alliance in promoting ICT for global society. I choose this topic because I feel that I have some very good memory and experience with regards to GITI, and I think GITI has demonstrated a very good institute to promote not only internationalization but also transnational collaboration between many countries, especially in Asia and Pacific. These are the content of my presentation. In brief, I will talk about what is the current trend in Malaysia with regards to higher education, very briefly. And then I will discuss a little bit about what we mean by transnational higher education in terms of concept, issues, and challenges. I also would like to share with you some of the best result of the collaboration between our countries, Japan and Malaysia, both in terms of higher education and also economics. Then I will go about my personal experience with GITI and how I see GITI as a very good platform to foster, to promote global cooperation and also to help people in many parts of Asia Pacific. I will highlight some of the contribution and achievement of GITI as what I see or I saw. There are many, of course, but these are through my personal experience, through conferences and forum, through human resource development programs, research and ICT projects, and then conclusion and acknowledgement. In Malaysia, before 2004, we have only one Ministry of Education, Mambusho. Only one, to look after the whole sector of education from elementary school to the university. But with the Vision 2020 introduced by our then Prime Minister Mahathir, he put a lot of emphasis on human resource development or human capital development for the country in order to achieve a developed country by the year 2020. Therefore, there is a need to focus on higher education. Therefore, in March 2004, the government split the ministry into two. One is Ministry of Education and a newly formed Ministry of Higher Education to look after universities, polytechnics, and technical colleges. Of course, the idea also is to increase more places for students to study in the universities, and to improve the quality of our higher education, and of course to make Malaysia as a hub for regional higher education, and at the same time to bring as many foreign students to Malaysia. Therefore, in order to implement this vision, the Ministry of Higher Education introduced two strategic plans. One is the National Higher Education Action Plan, and the other one is the National Higher Education Strategic Plan. These are the two documents. This is the first document that we introduced to make the foundation of higher education as strong as possible, and then followed by this strategic plan after 2010 and beyond. So this two documents is very important for us. I was very fortunate to be involved in some of the discussion and formulation of this strategic plan. In brief, there are four phases of this higher education strategic plan in Malaysia. One is the laying the foundation. It's already done. So we are supposed to have achieved all this. And now we are in this second phase. We call it strengthening and enhancement. From now, last year until 2015, our KPI or our objective is actually at least two universities from Malaysia to be in the top 100 by the year 2015. And now we already have six research universities in Malaysia, R&D centers of excellence, and our target is to have 100,000 international students. At the moment, we have about 85,000 already foreign students in Malaysia. And the third phase is, of course, from 2016 to 2020, we like to have at least three in the top 100 and one in the top 50, and to achieve at 100,000 PhDs graduate by the year 2023. And of course, beyond 2020, we would like to have some kind of sustainable excellence in terms of our higher education. So these are the four phases of our national strategic plan for higher education in Malaysia. Some statistics about our higher education sector in Malaysia. I only managed to gather statistics up to 2009. The ministry now are compiling statistics for 2011. You can see these are the public universities. There are four components: university, university colleges, polytechnic, and community college for what are called technical training, and we have the private universities. So the number of public universities have increased to 20, and you can see the private university also has increased from 5, 17 to 42 now. So this shows that there's some tremendous increase in terms of institution of higher learning in Malaysia in order to accommodate as many students so that they can pursue their education at the university or tertiary level. This is in terms of number of students, both public and private. So the total is about slightly more than 500,000 students at the moment in Malaysia. In fact, I managed to check the latest figure for 2011, slightly increased from close to 600,000 now. The number of students pursuing higher education in Malaysia. And in terms of foreign students, very small number, only 80,000 students from all over the world study in Malaysia. So that's about briefly the transformation of higher education in Malaysia. And there are many objective that we would like to achieve. And one of the main component is to transform our higher education in terms of internationalization and to have a global significance in terms of our role in higher education. So we adopt what we call transnational higher education as opposed to just internationalization of higher education. So briefly, it is a transnational higher education is actually the provision of education available in more than one country. Yeah. So, as defined by British Council, TNHE, in brief, delivering education where the learners are located in different country from the one where the awarding institution is based. So meaning that you can offer program offshore to other country, but awarding degree is, for instance, from Waseda, but your student is from all over the world. So I think that has been done. So I must congratulate Waseda and also GITI who have promoting this idea of not just internationalization, but transnational higher education. Basically, it requires national boundary to be crossed by information about education, meaning that a lot of movement not just about student and staff, but also information about material, curriculum, research project, and many more. So just to have a distinction between internationalization and transnational, I will explain later. Example of transnational higher education, like distance education, twinning program, branch campuses. In Malaysia now, we have at least 8 foreign universities in Malaysia. We have 3 from Australia, maybe 2 or 3 from UK, 1 from US. And recently, we have the Malaysian Japan International Institute of Technology last year. Yeah. And franchising, partnership in research and consultancy. The difference between internationalization and transnational is that internationalization is normally the desire of university to become internationalized, look international. You bring some foreign staff, you bring some foreign student, so that your university look like international. I don't know how you define international, but most of the Asian countries try to use Western university as a model, which is sometimes is not correct. Most of our students have exposed to Western education, but Western students have not exposed to Asian education. So it's like one-way traffic. Whereas transnational has to be of equal standing between the two universities to be in partnership. So therefore, there's an element of government and industry involvement in transnational. Why? Because we need to look at the cultural sensitivity. We need to look at how to bridge the quality gap between the two institutions, accreditation, and of course, use of English. I remember GITI started with a challenge to introduce English in a very predominantly Japanese-speaking university, but it has been very successful. Yeah. So this is a kind of transnational that we are talking about, not just merely internationalization. But there are challenges. Of course, we need to have, because there is involvement of government and industry, we need a very clear policy and regulation. And we need to use technology to support all these activities. There are many people who actually would like to come into this business as bogus or substandard providers of higher education. So we have to be careful. Again, I must mention here, transnational higher education is associated, but not necessarily identical to internationalization. Why? Because you can see, internationalization, as mentioned earlier, is just about how you want to be portray yourself, to look like one of these universities that you like to be associated with, or to look like, like a Western university or from the US or UK or Europe. So basically, international is just about developing a multilateral and multicultural learning and research environment, just to create an environment. For example, redesigning curricula, engaging non-local staff, bringing foreign staff to the university, encouraging students to study abroad. See? So very, very informal and very superficial kind of arrangement. Some example, actually, student mobility is not really formal. Just some kind of half a month semester, or just 2 weeks experience, exchange of staff, and also research collaboration. Now, I would like to proceed with the relationship between Japan and Malaysia. I use some of the information that I presented 2 years ago when Tominaga-sensei retirement lecture, but there's some updates. Look, its policy was introduced in 1982 by Tun Mahathir Mohamad, and I think we have more than 12,000 students, maybe close to 15,000 now, graduated from universities in Japan. And in my university, I have 50 of my junior staff or my academic staff are actually trained in Japan. So I have many of my staff actually, they can speak Japanese very well. And we have the government introduced a collaboration with the Japanese government. It's called Higher Education Loan Program. We are sending every year students to study undergraduate, master's, and PhD. This is the latest. There's a consortium of universities in Japan, I think more than 20 universities, working together with the Malaysian government and Malaysian universities to establish what we call Malaysian-Japan International Institute of Technology, MJIIT. Established 2010, and last year they already have intakes of students, I think about now more than 100 students, both undergraduate and postgraduate students. Yeah. So it is a significant milestone for the relationship between Malaysia and Japan. As far as my university is concerned, we are very fortunate because we have many friends in Japan. I personally very very lucky to have many colleagues and friends from Japan, and we have established many collaborations with universities and also other institutions like DTC, JICA, Japan Foundation, and also some private companies. Yeah. And UNIMAS also is very unique. My university is very unique because we are the only university in Malaysia was built by using Japanese money. So Malaysian government take a special loan to build my university. So you can see there are two portions of the funding for my university. 460 million ringgit using Malaysian government money, and the other is using the Japanese loan money. So I'm very lucky that because university, our university actually have developed in such a very nice university, a very big area. Now we have about 12,000 students. We were established in 1992. This year is going to be our 20th anniversary, very young university. And the area is 2,000 acres. And you can see the design are actually very much of more Japanese design, because the architect firm and the consultant are actually from Japan. So, members of the audience are most welcome to visit my university anytime. Now, with regards to economy, Japan has always been a very strong trading partner, yeah, for many, many years. So there are more than 1,400 Japanese companies now operating in Malaysia. Yeah. For the last 40 years. And these are some of the reasons why I think the Japanese company would like to come and invest in Malaysia. And now, with regards to where my university is, the state of Sarawak, Sarawaku, on the island of Borneo, next to Brunei, this is a big project now undertaken by the government, the state government of the prefecture, called it Sarawak Corridor of Renewable Energy, or SCORE. Because of Sarawak has a lot of water, the government has decided to use hydro as a source of energy and to sell energy to other people. At the moment, the government is constructing big dam to generate close to 3,000 megawatt, yeah, of electricity. And with this energy, the government is really trying to attract many foreign companies to establish their factories in Sarawak. So this is actually the former embassy of Japan to Malaysia, Mr. Hore. He is now very involved in the Malaysian-Japan International Institute of Technology, and he actually will become my visiting professor in the middle of this year. So he's very keen to talk about global warming, environmental issue, and so on. Now, I would like to go to GITI. As I mentioned earlier, my discussion this afternoon is more of my personal experience and observation since I was associated with GITI in 1998. I'm very lucky because when GITI was first started, I was a visiting researcher under Telecommunication Advancement Organization. So I had the opportunity to know Tominaga-sensei. He's Mr. Ichima, the Secretary General of AIC at that time. He's instrumental in bringing me to Waseda University, and of course none other than Professor Urano himself. And the lady with kimono dress is my wife, not a Japanese girlfriend. And of course, I had the opportunity to meet with people with Tao to discuss about the future planning for GITI at that time. So I'm very, very lucky and very fortunate to be involved in the initial stage of the formation of GITI. And of course, followed by a memorandum of understanding between UNIMAS and Waseda University. I think at that time, the president was Takayasu Okushima. Yeah. So, is it correct? Yes. So, we signed MOU because of my involvement with GITI at that time and because strong support from Tominaga-sensei and also Professor Urano. So this is the beginning of a good collaboration between UNIMAS and Waseda University. And Professor Urano appointed as our international advisor panel member. Yeah. And with that very good collaboration and partnership between Waseda and UNIMAS, this real transnational collaboration, GITI was involved in our conference called Conference on Information Technology in Asia since 2001. And it has been every time we organize this conference, GITI has been our co-organizer and supporter. So I would like to express my sincere thanks to GITI and also Waseda University for supporting our event. And this is the Chief Minister of Sarawak. How it all began, actually, my involvement with GITI in the first place, which is by luck and also, I think, God sent. Because it all began when UNIMAS hosted Asia ISDN Council at the time in Kuching in 1994. I think maybe some of you remember, this is Mr. Ichima, the Secretary General at the time. This is the conference in Kuching, and followed by the first conference of IT in Asia in 1999 before GITI involved in 2001. So we had the support of NTT MAC, which is a joint venture company between NTT and Telecom Malaysia, based in the Multi Super Corridor in Malaysia. This is how we started. Yeah? And now, the benefit of this collaboration, I can see as what I see. I'm sure there are many benefits that I cannot mention here, but this is from my own observation. Since then, GITI has been our partner in organizing the conference on IT in Asia, a biannual conference every 2 years. It has grown from a small conference to become a very prestigious and big conference. In fact, we have like speaker from Austria. Yeah. And of course, I was involved personally in a few of the GITI forum and seminar and workshops. And again, I would like to thank AIC for bringing closer the collaboration and the transnational collaboration between universities, but also because of the involvement of this kind of association, AIC. So you can see there are a lot of sharing of working together between Professor Arno and I. We were together at the working group 3 in AIC. We have been working very closely for the last, I think, maybe 10 years under AIC. And in terms of contribution and achievement of GITI, as I see it, not just in terms of organizing and collaborating in conferences and seminar or forum, in human resource development. I purposely will not touch on the master's and PhD program, but it's normal. There's the standard thing that GITI and GITS are doing, but these are beyond the normal tasks of GITI or GITS, that they actually involve in many human resource development in terms of developing new technology, new application, and new system to be used by people in various countries. Yeah? For instance, we have developed lecture on demand, a Chinese language system using 3G mobile phone, network application in distant learning. Yeah? When I was based in GITI in 1998, I developed or did an experiment on distant learning using wireless technology between Malaysia and Japan. And these are other projects that involve other countries like Vietnam. Yeah? And at the same time, we developed some kind of courseware to be used by students in any university that would like to use. So there's no cost to it. You know? We purposely developed together through small grant, and we developed a kind of computer-assisted instruction courseware, yeah, with many partners, Waseda, GITI, UNIMAS, and many other universities. We developed a courseware on wireless technology, understanding mobile IP, advanced mobile IP, basic NGN, and also advanced NGN. This courseware actually available and can be used for free by students in the university. So this is a kind of transnational higher education that we are talking about, and I think GITI has achieved, yeah, what I think we can say to further develop the enrichment of higher education to the global society. And of course, there are other things that we do, as I see it, in terms of projects, research and ICT projects. Being GITI, meaning the Global Information and Telecommunication Institute, the focus is ICT. So ICT has to be the main core research areas that GITI were doing from then until now. So these are the list of the project that I think we have done, and I personally and Professor Urano have been involved. Yeah, there are many projects. Yeah. But basically, most of the projects are with regards to providing ICT for the remote areas, for remote community, whether in Malaysia, in Indonesia, in Vietnam, in other parts of the world. Yeah. Just to give an example, these are the projects that we have done. Some of them are with the involvement of GITI, GITS. These are very remote areas in Sarawak and also in Sabah, the two states in Malaysia. They are very remote, in the jungle, in the mountain, and this actually in the island. No electricity, no telephone line. Yeah? So we have to walk in the jungle for a couple of days in order to reach the destination. Just to give an example, the kind of collaboration, this transnational collaboration involving projects and research activities. This is an example of the remote area. This is the barrio. We introduced the first time last year what we call community radio for remote community in the jungle. So they have their own radio system now. I officially officiate that. And barrio started in 1999, and last year we have an international conference in the jungle. We have 200 participants from all over the world. Yeah? So this is to show that transnational collaboration doesn't mean that we bring people to the city, but city people go to the remote areas so that they can understand better how to connect urban and rural areas, people. This example of our collaboration with Professor Rano, with the team from KDDI, we experiment long-range Wi-Fi and now already installed in the jungle of Borneo. And use solar energy so that it's self-sustained. There is no need for electricity, and they can go up to 10 kilometers. This is the coverage of the villages in the jungle. Now they are access to Wi-Fi, long-range Wi-Fi, and connected through satellite to access the internet. Yeah. So this is the kind of thing to create the global society that actually this very little gap with regards to accessing the ICT. This is the latest one. We joint venture with DTC. We are doing a project to put a fiber optic network in the jungle. So this again, we must bring technology to the people who are not accessible to this technology. Rather than we wait for them to come to us. Yeah. We are working with Mitsubishi and also Sumitomo Electric and also NTT for this project. Again, transnational is not just about institutional, university, government, or industry, but the person involved must be also of a certain criteria or quality. So I said here that personal touch is very important, one of the key success factors for this transnational education. I think most of the students, international students, recognize that Professor Urano is very accommodating, understanding, and knows the sensitivity between cultures of the student that he has been supervised. So you can see, these are some of the pictures I hope Professor Urano also treasure, that this collaboration not just about institutional, not just about government, but also personal. Yeah. As a conclusion, transnational collaboration is key to globalization, and higher education has a major role to play. ICT is the main technology to bridge this gap. Yeah, so GITI is very important. Universities and government should focus on the benefit to the society that will result from transnational collaboration in higher education, research, joint project, and human resource development. Institutional and personal commitment, as I mentioned, are key success factors in this kind of collaboration. Issues and challenges can be solved through strategic alliances and partnerships such as GITI. Lastly, I would like to acknowledge Waseda University, the president and the management of this university, for giving the opportunity in 1998 to be part of this very prestigious and very important institution, GITI. And of course, Professor Kameyama, Dean of GITS, for inviting me officially. Of course, Tomonaga Sensei, Urano, the Japanese government, including the embassies and Consulate General Office in Malaysia, Asia Pacific Telecommunity for giving some of the grants, AIC, of course, DTC, and of course, these two institutions for research center in INIMAS for their support and also for their commitment to continue this transnational collaboration. So with that, I would like to say thank you and happy retirement to Professor Urano. It is an honor for me to be here. Thank you very much.